We're very lucky that Lem's here, because he's quite busy. As of May, there's been a video installation of his in a heritage lighthouse on the southwestern tip of Norway. In mid-May, they rebroadcast on the BBC World Service his documentary on Bob Marley, One Love, the Legacy of Bob Marley. There's another event late in May, but we'll come back to that later on. Second half of June, he was the poet in residence at the Grassington Festival, which is a town in North Yorkshire. And the convener of that festival has recorded that he left for every letterbox in the town a special present at the end of the festival. We'll leave that one for a bit later too, maybe, eh?
Yeah.
In July, Lem curated yet another festival at Southend-on-Sea. Shorelines, a literary festival of the sea. And it turned out to be a very stormy and dramatic weekend to be doing a literary festival about the sea. It happened to be the same weekend that about 50 miles east, southeast, an Irishman who knew how to hit the ball under the wind won the Open in Kent. And then on the 31st of July, the BBC rebroadcast a documentary of Lem's, Why I Don't Hate White People. So the fact that he's got time to come here is almost a bit of a surprise. We could say a lot more about those things, and we will, but I want to digress for a moment. Careful, all of you who were there last night. I've been thinking about Norman Greenwood. And when I think about Norman Greenwood, I get a picture of a guy who he's about 67. He's recently retired from a lifetime service at the BBC, where he conceived and produced one after another of successful BBC programs that allowed people like Stephen Fry to show off in public. But no one knows who he is unless they look at the closing credits. I think that's a pretty plausible picture of someone called Norman Greenwood, but it's quite wrong. Tell us about Norman Greenwood. What was he like?
Well, just for those of you who are not aware, who didn't see the play, I should tell this story to clarify. When I was born, I came to my mother came to England to study, and she had me fostered for a short period of time to a social worker whose name was Norman. The social worker gave me to foster parents who wanted to adopt me, and they believed that God had told them that I was a chosen one for them. And they, but they weren't allowed to adopt me because I was being fostered for a short period of time. The social worker in 1967 had no intention of giving me back to my mother, who'd given me to him to have me fostered for a short period of time when he studied. He gave me to the foster parents and he said, treat this as an adoption. He's yours forever. We'll get her to sign the adoption papers. We're just having a little trouble at the moment, but we'll get that sorted. So they took me forever. And he said, but you can't name him. His name's Norman. When in fact, that was the name of the social worker, and he'd named me after himself, and that was his decision. They wanted to call me Mark after Mark in the Bible. So my name, up until 11 years old, was Norman Mark Greenwood. Greenwood is a very Lancashire name. It's a very Rochdale name, actually West Yorkshire. And at 11 years old, their experiment sort of wasn't working, and they thought that I had the devil inside of me, and that I was like a Trojan horse that had been sent into their house to do something. To me, they were just my mum and dad. So they put me into care. The children's homes held me for the next 6.5 years till I was 17 and a half. And I was in about 5 different children's homes. And the last one I was in was an assessment center. After being in care for what was 17 and a half years, they deemed it necessary to assess me. It was basically a lockup. There was a quiet room, a panic room, where children were put that was had padded cells. And on leaving the children's homes at 17 and a half, they had to give me my birth certificate to... Is this okay? You know, but I have to contextualise the name.
Absolutely. Because, that's what I wanted you to do.
They gave my birth certificate... They had to give me back my birth. Normally, at 18 years of age, they would give the birth certificate to a responsible adult, a surrogate parent, an auntie or an uncle, a foster parent. But there was absolutely nobody. I realised at 17 and a half that I hadn't sat down and had a dinner with a family in all of those years, and how those little things start to matter, your arguments about not what you don't like and what you don't want to eat, and having somebody who could be bothered to tell you that you've got to eat it, even if you don't want to eat it, and what's that about? And you storm out, and that's part of the glue that holds family together, something that you often only realise when it's not there, when many years later somebody passes away and you think, God, or you have children yourself, and you start to realise, oh my God, that's why my mum, you suddenly form a relationship with all of those arguments. There were no arguments to form a relationship with, and I was aware of that at the time. There was nobody that I knew at 17 and a half years old that I had known for longer than a year, because they moved from the children's homes in and out, staff changed every 4 hours, and I was the only one who knew, who could put two and two together, who knew that this was happening, who knew that all family is a group of disputed memories over a lifetime. And I didn't have it. I knew it because I didn't have it. And I wouldn't wish that realisation on my worst enemy. At 17 and a half years old, they had to give me my birth certificate. And my birth certificate had my name on it, Lemn Sissay. And it was at that moment that I realised that the things that had happened to me that I knew to be wrong, that nobody took the responsibility for, were wrong. And this was a truth. And that was the beginning of something of which I had no idea, but it was the beginning of something. And truth is all I had. And I was given letters. The social worker was so angry with what had happened to me. He said, somebody did love you. And he gave me letters from my mother pleading for me back, dated 1968, in which she said, I want Lemn back. I want him to be with his own people in his own country. I don't want him to face discrimination. And from that day onwards, I chose the name that was the only truth that I'd known, which was Lemn Sissay. And so that's sort of some of the story. I was supposed to somehow descend into sort of madness, possibly, be pumped full of drugs in the children's homes, quite possibly. But what I was not supposed to do was to be able to articulate my own story, and that was absolutely what I had to do. In some ways, I was going to say in some ways for my own sanity, but I don't believe that. I don't believe that the people who were entrusted to look after me have any understanding of the nature of insanity. I remember thinking that the staff in the children's homes were more institutionalized than the children because they had been there for longer. And you know what? They were. They genuinely were. I'm now in a position to be able to do things regarding these matters, and I do. But that's another story. So who's Norman? Well, I'll tell you. I mean, Norman, as a child, you know, as the only black in the village, I had to make everybody smile, you know, had to do his utmost, had to do his utmost to make everybody feel okay around him so that people would... Norman had to be liked. Is absolutely who I am. I mean, who I am is who I always was, which was Lemn Sissay. The imposition was Norman that had nothing to do with me, though the person that was called Norman is the person who stood in front of you now. There is no contradiction. Does that make sense? And all that childhood, adulthood is adulthood is to me is a sort of consolidation of your childhood. However you may perceive yourself to be beyond your childhood, the more you perceive yourself to be beyond it, the more actually in relation to it you are, I believe. Yeah.
But Norman was looking for Lemn.
No. I mean, I'm not. Okay. Well, let me just go with that. Let me go with it. Okay. Norman was looking for Lemn.
Where's Bob Marley come in? When does Bob Marley come into your life?
Oh, Bob Marley came into my life around my sort of early teens, like 13, 14,
and. Yeah.
Marley sort of spoke about knowing yourself and sort of, mm-hmm. and I believed in asking questions, and I always found that in the children's homes, I was never given answers to my questions. What was I? I'm going to come back to this Norman thing because it's quite freaked me out a bit.
Sorry.
But what was I at 11 years old? What was I on the edge of? Puberty, man. I was an adolescent. I was their first adolescent. They thought I had the devil inside of me. They'd never, I blimey did have a devil inside of me. No, they thought they just were coming across their first adolescent. They'd had three other children. The last one was an accident. She was like 6 months, 7 months old. Dear me. It's the saddest thing.
There's a local contrast. Well, a shared experience and a contrast. It's a man whose name was Bruce Trevorrow. And Bruce lived about halfway down the Coorong, was born there. And when he was 13 months old, he was very ill. And his mother and father brought him to Adelaide, to what is now the Women's and Children's Hospital. He needed treatment. And the state of South Australia stole him. The state of South Australia stole him.
Yeah.
Same story. Attempts to get in touch with the fostering, with the so-called welfare authorities.
Yeah.
Where is my baby? Languid brush-offs.
Yeah.
Bruce didn't recover.
Yeah, a lot of
from
people don't.
That, and eventually, a man who we knew was always destined to be a Supreme Court judge because he was a real nerd in the law school, Justice Tom Gray. Found against the state of South Australia and in favour of Bruce Trevorrow. But you did recover.
Yeah, I mean, they're but for the grace of God or whoever you want to believe in, go I. But actually, I think one of my saving graces was that the strangest thing was that I had absolutely no family. I had absolutely nobody to run away to. Nobody to relate to. There was nobody, you know, I once ran back to the children's, to the foster parents. I couldn't understand what they'd done and sat in their front room and they kept me like I was an official visitor and called the social worker. It was the strangest thing. But what I mean is there was nobody who was accountable to me. So this is why I believe that at base we are good as human beings, all of us. That's including the people that we perceive to be bad, you know, as a general theme, as in England, in the riots at the moment, you know, they're bad people. I believe we were born good, and I believe that I've been to that place as a child where I've had to ask myself, am I intrinsically bad? You know, we're talking about somebody who's not done things here, by the way. I've not, you know, smashed windows or robbed cars or, you know, I did glue sniff when I was in the children's home. And I did decide at about 14 years old that I was going to smoke, yada yada. But I did say to my social worker, because I tell you the truth, I'm going to tell you that I'm doing this, because the truth is all I've got. And that freaked him out a bit. But he loved me for it.
At all this time, you're a brown-skinned adolescent amongst a whole lot of pink-skinned
Well, I hope so, because otherwise it's a bit freaky.
But you're amongst a whole lot of pink-skinned people.
Yeah.
You're still very much in a minority.
Yeah, I was utterly in a minority. I mean, racism is a personal story, deeply, deeply personal. You know, we get talked about so much in such a sort of cleansed areas of argument and discussion that it becomes depersonalized, like sexism. It's deeply personal. It's riven within the story of not the people, but each individual, collected in a series of moments that have knock-on effects on other moments and on personal growth. And from the moment my name was changed to Norman Greenwood, from the moment my mother had me fostered and the social worker decided that she was not good enough to be listened to, racism was established very early on within my life as a sort of director to who and what I should be.
And it's produced quite a few poems.
It's not produced the poems.
You have.
I mean, I would write about anything else but racism. I mean, one of the biggest struggles I have as an artist is to be able to not allow my sort of creative spirit, which is bigger than any subject matter, to be folded inside a subject as small as racism.
It should never be folded inside any subject.
Absolutely. I mean, I fight for the right to be for the creative spirit. I think we're born creative, and we're slowly taught as we grow to how not to be, and then we retire and decide that we should be writing our novel now, or we start knitting. We search for that creative expression that we know was always central to what and who we are. And in fact, people use creativity all the time in the decisions that you make for your children, in the clothes that you wear, in the way your hair is, in the jokes that you tell, in the conversation at the dinner table, in the way that you navigate your lives, And it's just that we're denied that. We're denied seeing that as creative spirit. And if we weren't, who was it that told us, oh, you're a builder, you can't be a poet? Oh, you're a cleaner, you can't be a painter? Who made those rules? You can have your cake and eat it.
Well, you ought to know the span of your creativity is as wide as anyone's that I can imagine. I mean, just the list of that I gave of the recent things that have been going on in public, but that's only a tiny part of it. Was there ever a risk of you being folded, enclosed?
I'm always...
You could have been a rapper.
I could have been, I don't know what to say.
It's too narrow.
I think that, like most writers, I'm not just, they don't just write in one form, for example. The poets come journalists, come novelists, come short story writers, etc., etc. There are a lot of poets like Derek Walcott who are also painters. There are musicians who are painters. I think the creative kind of force is so alive that it finds ways to express itself. If you're lucky enough to have found what it is you believe, I feel blessed, I feel lucky.
You'd found the writing early.
I did, I did.
You had some poems.
Oh God,
You had your birth certificate.
I was writing poems when I had my birth certificate. I just want to say that, I proved these things. I went back to the children's home. I made a documentary on Radio 4 called Child of the State last year. And I went back to the children's homes. I wanted to own memory, because that's all family is. So I went back to the children's homes to interview people who knew me, to see what Norman was like, to see myself reflected somewhere.
Yeah.
I wanted it documented. And so I went back to the children's homes and this cleaner, it's always the cleaners. The cleaners are like the kind of social worker, multitaskers, really. And I always got on with the cleaners because they were non-linear. They didn't, clock off at the same time. And she said, oh, you were always writing poetry. You were, You were in corner with your pen and paper. Oh, loads of paper and a bloody guitar. And that was, you know, that was broadcast last year on Radio 4, and it was just wonderful proof that I was what I've always been, which is a writer. And I did have a fistful of poems and my birth certificate at 18 years of age. Yeah.
That's pretty amazing in itself.
I knew what I wanted to be. I knew at school what. In fact, I've just been contacted by Lord Putnam, who's like the head of the Film Council in Britain and the head of culture or something or other. And he wanted me to take a. He wanted me to have a picture taken in the Guardian newspaper. Me and six other people. This happened while I was here, just before I came here. And he wants me with my creative influence. He said he wants me with a teacher. And I've been able to call my old teacher, one English teacher that I had for 4 years, Mr. Unsworth, a bold socialist rugby-playing English teacher from the north of England. This is so Kez, it's unbelievable. If any of you have seen Kez. And I called him up just before I came here to have this photo shoot, which I'm going to have when I get back. I'm really proud of that, by the way, because that's some relation to my past. Important. And it's poetry that's done that.
And an important teacher.
It's not family, it's not blah, it's not the social workers, it's not the blah, it's not the gathering of evidence, it's the writing of poetry which has bridged that gap between the physical space I'm in now and the spiritual journey to where I was then. It's wonderful.
Now, there are lots of books of poems, some of them out there, they're on sale. But other things happen to Lemn's poems. Can we have a look at the pub?
Yeah, this was the first one. I was asked, I was with a friend at this bar, it's called Hardy's Well in Manchester, and I was with a friend, and he knew the bar guy who owned the place, and he said, oh, I bet you can't write a poem. Your friends never think you do what you do they? You know what I mean? I bet you can't write a poem for us. So I decided that I would write a poem. This is the middle of the student district of Manchester. It's also on the edge of the main Asian area, Asian as in Indian and Pakistan, people from India and Pakistan. And so I wanted to write a poem on the side of the pub. I wanted it to not mention alcohol. And I, you know, you always have your little secret moments in poems that you write that are just for you. And mine is that there are lots of drunk people who stand outside of this wall late at night trying to read it without making a mistake. That the people in the pub think it's an incredible thing that they put it up on the wall. And yet the whole poem does not mention alcohol. In fact, the first line is, wait, waterless wanderer. Whoever walks to the well will wade into a wondrous world, a world which will waken the wilting wallpaper of work and worry. Well, worry will wait while well's wand whirls a warm-hearted wackiness into a weary week, whereafter waves and waterfalls of wonderment will wash all weakness away. Well, a worldwide web of whole-hearted, wholesome wisdom and wit waits, wipe away worries. Wells works wonders for wrinkles. Why wait? Why wonder? Why worry? Why wane? Why whittle? Why wither? Walk in. Well, what are we waiting for? It'll double you at Hardy's Well. Yeah. Yeah, there are lots of grammatical oddities in there for the people who've seen them. But
you just saw something else. How many poets have you heard do their own work as well as that?
Well, poets are always best people to read their work, and it doesn't mean to say, like, read it in a grandiose, blah, blah way. I love listening to, like, Seamus Heaney read in his like, monotone, you know, wonderful lilt of Northern Ireland, and sort of Simon Armitage read in his sort of laconic, is that the right word? Sort of Yorkshire, sort of working man's stroke, not working man's accent, and Jackie Kaye's beautiful Edinburgh lilt. Which is like, you know, sort of like, I don't know, sort of like a trapeze kind of voice, you know. So I love listening to people speak. I love listening to people speak who can't speak properly. I think that, you know, when you read your own work, something happens, actually.
You said that was the first one, Lem. When was it?
Yeah.
When was it?
I don't know, actually. I have got a date somewhere. I think it's 1995, 90, something like that.
This is...
I think something like that.
You're in your mid-20s. Or
1995,
late
20s. Wait a minute. Yeah. 87, 97. Well, yeah, I'm getting late 20s, early, getting on from the early 30s if it's 1997. Yeah.
By this time, you've published two books of verse, I think.
Ten of Fingers in a Clenched Fist.
Then?
Rebel Without Applause. Yeah, something like that. Rebel Without Applause.
And Tender Fingers in a Clenched Fist is published only a handful of years after you got your birth certificate.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, 3 years. Within 3 years of leaving the children's home, my first book's published by... there's a lot of press. I think I was much more successful there, whatever success is as a poet. It's a bit of a contradiction, successful poet, but... within 3 years of leaving the children's homes, I've got a double page in the Guardian newspaper that says Lemn Sissay has success written all over his forehead. It's not there. Not only is it not there, it was an incredibly dangerous thing for me to see or to read because I had no family and I felt utterly out of context and it felt dangerous to be recognised in any way as being successful because to me successful was being able to look in the mirror and know that I was okay, and I wasn't, and I knew that I wasn't. I had to find my family.
But accepting all of that, that book gets published
very
quickly.
Hardback, now, paperback, yeah.
Now, at this stage, you are working with Common Word.
That's right, yeah. Well,
now, Common Word still exists.
Yeah, it
does. It's a terrific organisation for developing and assisting young writers.
That's right, and community, you know, community writers. It's funny because the word community became equated with not really that good, but you know, it was worthy. You know, and I was quite angry at the time. I was angry at the time because there was the perception, and I used to say this at the workshops we used to give, discussions we used to have, which was, I was quite angry at the time that the idea of being a community writer somehow meant that you belittled the act of writing and that critique was central to us getting better as writers, and that is what was necessary within those community environments, was a really strong sense of critique that happened within this group that would meet, say, once a week. I really wanted to push for that, and I was 21, yeah, I was 21, 22. I went to Manchester. I had a little book of poems that I printed in Lancashire, stapled in the middle, called Perceptions of the Pen. I'm sorry. Perceptions of the Pen as a title is as bad as Reflections. I brought that and I went for this job. Went to Manchester, I went for this job and I got it. And I looked later on in the file at the people who'd gone for the job and they were all degrees this and that and the other. And I got it based on my instinctive answers to questions like, how will you develop black writing in Manchester if there are no black writers that are visible? And I said, I would go into post offices and I would ask people who worked there. And I would go to, I said, if you want to know about bricklaying, you ask bricklayers and you go to houses and you ask what kind of bricks they, literally use that metaphor, that analogy, and I got the job. What the hell is that about? I mean, a few years earlier, I was walking barefoot. So these things are like flags in the mountainside that tell you, keep going, keep doing what it is that you're doing, you know. That book I took to that job interview, I paid for out of my dole money. I was on the dole for 6 months ever in my life when I left the children's homes. And I paid for it weekly to the printer.
It was going to happen then, wasn't it? It had to happen.
Yeah, it did. I am what I was meant to be.
And the reason I was asking about to try to put a time on the Hardy's Well work is that it's still very early and you are developing, you have developed the sort of public reputation that gets you these sorts of gigs. Can we have a look at another one? Can we have a look at another Manchester one, The Street? Now, this image, we've stretched the limits of this image possibly beyond tolerance, but it does give you enough of a picture for Lemn to talk to.
It's a 12-verse poem, longer than 12 verses, and it's inlaid into a street which is a mile long in the centre of Manchester called Tibb Street. And in fact, it's ruined. It's been ruined. It was terribly done in the sense that the materials all, like, within 5-6 years, all depleted. So there's my signature at the end of the street there, which I'm incredibly proud of. And they're in the process at the moment, actually, of redoing it, they're going to take it out of the street and put it up somewhere else. I'm very proud of that. It was a commission from Manchester City Council.
And that goes back to roughly
1997? No, 1999, actually, probably. 99, yeah.
It doesn't stop. Last one, the square, please.
Yeah, no, there's lots of... I mean, I've done lots of these now. This one was commissioned by the City of London. It was unveiled by Bishop Desmond Tutu. And if you go to my Facebook page, you'll see a picture of me on my Facebook profile. It's just I put it up recently for other reasons, but a picture of me and Desmond Tutu, the bishop, and it was at that launch that picture was taken. And he unveiled that. And there's a poem, and it's called Guilt of Cain. And it's talking about the guilt of Cain, G-I-L-T of C-A-I-N, but it's also talking about the guilt of cane, sugar cane, which was part of the industry in the city of which a lot of London is, especially the Docklands, is based on. It's talking, and it's also about Am I My Brother's Keeper and Wilberforce. That sculpture is on the land that where the church is, where the pastor was the man who wrote Amazing Grace, the song. And so there's links with that in the poem as well. And all of the language used in the poem is taken from Bloomsburg's financial glossary. It's wonderful glossary of language that the financiers use, like in concert, and many, 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 many other terms that we use in our everyday language.
Yes. I'm going to come back to something that I teased about when we began. I referred to an event which took place in late May, in between that rebroadcast of the Bob Marley documentary and the Grassington Festival. And that event was on the 27th of May, when Gil Scott-Heron died.
Mm-mm. You missed that out before, so I thought...
That's why I left it out. Okay, that's why I was skipping it. Okay. Because I think that is probably... was quite a bit an important day.
I'm not that good on deaths or marriages or births for that matter, but so he died. I knew he was going to die. I said 2 days earlier I'd had a discussion with a woman called Suzette Newman, who was Bob Marley's tour manager in England, and she was she's Barbara Marles' manager. Barbara Marles, an incredible musician from West Africa. And I said to her a couple of days ago that if Gil died, he has left the perfect goodbye note in his last album, which was produced by XL Records, and his last book, which was published by my good friend and publisher, Jamie Bing. And I said that 2 days before he died, and then he did. And I do believe it is right. I do believe he passed at the right time. I was, you know, this morning, I thought... There was something on TV, and they said, oh, he's had a short life. And I thought, you can't have a short life, because your life is as long as your life lasted. It can't be short, can it? It can only be short...
Only by measuring
if it wasn't a lot... Do you know what I mean? It can't be short.
Only by measuring it against someone else's,
well, yes,
which is not
yours.
Well, yes,
but it can't be a short life. It's not your life. It is your entire life in its entirety. Isn't that a wonderful thing to think? Wasn't a short life. And his wasn't a short life. And he was somebody who went through an element of self-destruction, which can often happen to artists who are playing with fire. We are playing with fire.
I sense that I might need to explain Gil Scott-Heron a little bit. He's known in some quarters as the father of hip-hop.
Yeah.
And like all fathers, the child went in directions which rather surprised him and of which he didn't always approve. Uh-huh. And the scary thing for all of, for a very large proportion of this audience, is that Gil was born about a year after me. Mm-hmm. And Lemn made a documentary about him.
Yeah, I did, yeah.
A few years ago now?
Yeah, yeah, just a couple of years ago, yeah. 2 years ago, yeah. I went over to see him in Harlem. I hung out with him.
Gil said of 90s, is supposed to have said, I mean, I haven't done the scholarly work to track down the quote, but he's supposed to have said of 90s hip-hop, they ought to learn music. I played in a band before I began writing. Putting words over music is not the same as fitting words into music. But you didn't learn music. But you do a lot of words and music.
Well, I play with music because I love music, and I feel like when I play with music, I'm a musician. So, and as I'd never went to university or to college, and yet I'm a writer, inadequate, actually, I feel, but a writer all the same. So too, I have a certain amount of instinct for music and musicians, and I like to play, you know.
I'm going to change the subject because we have to finish and let the people have a go.
Oh, yeah, okay.
But there's one thing I want to pick up. You mentioned Baba Mal.
Yeah.
Who has an online paper.
Yeah, yeah.
For which you wrote an article in the last issue. And I'll pluck out one quote from it, which Baba also plucked out. Poetry is at the heart of revolution because revolution is in the heart of the poet.
Mm-hmm. Pretty good, that. Yeah.
Pretty topical.
I shot myself sometimes.
It was pretty. It was pretty topical too, because it was about what had been building up in the Middle East.
That's right. Yeah.
Can you tell our friends a little more about that theme and what drove you about that?
The poems were chanted in Tahrir Square. Poems were chanted in was Tahrir Square, Egypt? Is that right? In Tunisia. And in various other places, and poems were written and sung throughout the struggle between the Republicans in Northern Ireland. Wherever there's revolution, there's poetry. Wherever there's peacetime, there's poetry. Wherever there's a funeral, there's poetry. Wherever there's a birth, there's poetry. It's around us all the time. It's muscular. And it's spiritually muscular, and whenever we need that strength, it's there for us. And I'm constantly sort of narked by the idea that poetry is some sort of fey, sort of weak, sort of brother of culture that sort of sits in a sort of back room scribbling effeminately. Effeminately is wrong term, you know, and shoving pieces of paper through its door. It's us that are frightened of it, that we have to sort of like minimalize it to the best of our ability because it tells the truth. And then when we really need it, then we turn to it and we let it breathe at funerals, births, marriages, Valentine's Day. We let it breathe then. And then we've got to close it down quick because poetry is the person who comes to the dinner party and says, okay, what's going on here?
And provides the answer before the politicians get there?
Yeah, well, of course it will because the politicians is having, you know, sort of really inadequate way of having to deal with stuff, whereas I think poetry is much more truthful and honest about the sort of just truthful and honest, yeah.
Truthful and honest is a good place to pause. We scratch the surface. It's sort of like getting to know Lemn a little bit in a speed dating exercise.
Hey, I like that, okay.
And if you've ever done speed dating, you get to know someone a little bit, but it's pretty unsatisfying.
I always thought speed dating was a drug reference myself, and then I realised that it wasn't.
So in pursuit of further satisfaction, I think it's time for me to be quiet and for you to ask some questions. Thanks, Liz.
Actually, I've got two questions. The first I would ask, could you read that poem to us? Because it's not large enough for me, at least, to read. And the second question, did you ever trace your mother?
Oh, wow.
And other family?
Well, does somebody else want to answer that? Who came to the play? Yeah. I did trace, yeah, I did. I mean, I had to, and I spent most of my adult life actually finding the family and proving what happened to me as a child. So I did find her, yeah. And as I say in the play, I've now got a fully dysfunctional family, just like everybody else. So yes, I did find her. And the strangest thing for her was that I looked like the last time she saw my father. So she didn't see me, she saw him. And I didn't realize that, and of course, neither did she. And that's when I realized it wasn't my story after all. For all of what my story was, it wasn't about me. That was the strangest sort of flip of kind of reality that happened within the first day of us meeting. It's the most beautiful sort of turn of viewpoint and perspective and everything. Yeah, so this poem, yeah, this is Guilt of Cain, and I just published this in the last book. I'll read some of it to you, maybe, not all of it. So I used financial terms from the Bloomberg glossary, and it was commissioned by the City of London, which is the financial heart of Europe, and it was unveiled by Bishop Desmond Tutu. The Guilt of Cain. Here is the ask price on the closed position. History is no inherent acquisition, for here the technical correction upon the act, a merger of truth and in actuals fact, on the spot, on the money, the spread. The dealer lied when the dealer said the bull was charging, the bear was dead, the market must calculate per capita, not head. And great traders acting in concert, arms rise as the actuals fraught on the sea of franchise, thrown overboard into the exchange to drown in distressed brokers' disconsolate frowns. In accounting liquidity is a mounting morbidity, but raising the arms with such rigid rapidity, over reaping the raping rapacious fluidity, the violence, the vicious and vexed volatility. The roaring trade floor rises above crashing waves. The traders buy ships beneath the slaves. Sway machete back, sway machete again. Crick, crack, cut back, the sugar rush, cane, the whipsaw, it's all, and the whip saw it all, the rising market and the cargo fall. Who'll enter Jerusalem? Make the margin call for Abel. Who will kick over the stall and turn the table? Cain gathers Cain as guilt gift to his land. But whose sword of truth shall not sleep in hand? Who shall unlock the stocks and share? Break the bond, the bind unbound, lay bare the truth. Cash flow runs deep, but spirit deeper. You ask the question, am I my brother's keeper? I answer the best way I can, through laws. My name, my brother, Wilberforce. Thank you. Thank you.
So there you have it, that he doesn't just talk about poetry being muscular. He takes a whole lot of language that has been designed to strip the meaning out of what is being said. Mm. And he puts it on a gym course, and that's the result.
Jeff, we'll get a microphone for you, Jeff. Another poet.
Have you written anything about the recent riots in Britain? Or do you have any comment on that if you haven't written anything?
For reasons connected to my story, I write a blog. Whether anybody reads it or not, it really doesn't matter to me. It's proof that I was alive at some given time. And I was literally 1 minute from where the murder happened, or the killing happened of the child, that began the first peaceful march of the that then sparked off the riots. And I wrote a blog about the riots, which was called Who Are the Criminals? Who are the criminals? And because of that blog, while I was here, I was invited to do the World Service and to do a BBC TV program, neither of which I did. So yes, I have spoken about it. I've not written a poem about it. I was asked to write a poem for the World Service, but I don't. I stopped doing that because they call you at very inopportune moments to say, could you write a poem about the riots crossed with some other scandal? Do you know what I mean? And it's sort of, after a few years of doing
a
that,
poem. You think,
I mean, it's a particular skill, being able to write to order quickly and being able to deliver. And I can do it, but it's quite dispiriting at times. Anyway, I wrote the blog, and that was enough that I wanted to do, and that got spoken about and in various places. And yeah, and my friend who
until
I
that pompous man went on the television.
Pardon?
Until
oh,
the
no, I wrote about him as well.
Television.
In fact, I wrote about him, and I've just got asked to do the World Service on the 27th because of the blog I wrote about him. But David Starkey, what nobody understood about the... There was a pompous man who came on television, and basically he said, most black people are, you know, they're all criminals. He didn't say most black people are criminals. He said they're from a criminal background, blah, blah, blah.
The whites have become black was his great line.
They're always talking about guns and blah, blah. I'm like, well, what was Rambo? You know what I mean? It's like our entire culture, the white sort of like mainstream culture, is based on the gun from everything that I've seen since I was a child watching television. And yet, you know, people don't say all white people are sort of gangs of gun-toting animals. Well, but that's all I see on television. Literally, I'll see it tonight when I go home. But yet, anyway, blah, blah, blah. So I wrote a blog about him. And what was I saying? The vanity of historians.
That's right.
The vanity of historians. He knew that taking a pop at the vulnerable people would get him a lot of publicity. And it's the vanity of historians that he can put himself there as a spokesperson for a particular viewpoint, knowing that he has no interest in that viewpoint and that it will bring attention to who he is. The king for whom he was the jester was the BBC Newsnight producer. and I saw that in him. And I don't know why everybody's getting worried about him, because he's utterly transparent. And I believe that he should be allowed to do what he does, but we should know what he is doing.
We've got time for just one or two more questions. The lady back.
Last night, there was a discussion, I think it was Hal Jacobson talking about that and saying that it wasn't right. So we have heard about that man.
Right.
But what I was going to ask you, looking at that art, the Tracy Emin exhibition at the Saatchi, what worries me, and I wondered if you thought about it, is the connection between advertising, power gurus, and promoting the self-destruction, the detritus, the sort of terrible sort of images, or was that just art reflecting life and mirroring it? Was it a good thing, or is it something that led those kids? They read it in the News of the World, they mightn't go to art galleries, but they would know about that sort of image.
I don't understand totally the question, but I will try to answer you in saying that, you know, all artists from, if you go back in the history of art, not that I've got the history of art, for those of you who have, it's all about self-promotion on one degree, on one level. Whether that's the person who's being painted, like all of the pictures that are in the National Portrait Gallery are people who could afford to have their painting taken so that they could then promote themselves and their positions. The artist could also write themselves into history books by doing those paintings. So, you know, which is worse? Is it the artist that does that, or is it Tracy Emin who shows her own bed? If an artist says it is art, then it is art. Whether you like it or not is another matter. But if the artist says it's art, it is art. But whether you like it or not is another matter. You know, the public gets what the public wants. as the Jam once said. No, I think that I like her. I know there are a million reasons not to like her, and I wonder whether the reasons not to like her are promoted in much the same way as the reasons to like her. So you've got to like her for a deeper reason than the fact that she seems populist or it doesn't seem like art. There has to be much more to it than that. I mean, they said the same thing about the Liverpool poets, you know, and Merseybeat and the Beat poets. You know, they were cheapening literature. I wonder if they said the same thing about Shakespeare when he was putting gigs on in town, immediately writing his work.
He's making up words,
too. He was just doing it on
the spot. He's making up his own words.
Yeah. Just reacting to what was happening at the time. You know, so I think it's an interesting discussion to have, but not to be closed to. I think we deserve to be open to it, whether we like it or not.
Thanks.
That's an instinctive answer rather than an artistically informed answer.
Gentlemen here, thank you. Just wait for the microphone. Thank you.
You gave us an image of what freedom isn't. What is freedom, and can we achieve it?
It's just a lovely question, isn't it? Rather than what, you know, it's just a lovely question. I do think that if we sort of can't perceive what freedom is, then we can't fight for it, you know. It has to be sort of something that's sort of a living in us that we try to our best to cultivate.
Do we imagine it?
Well, freedom of imagination is really important, and I think that's part of it. It gives me like a nice warm feeling. I think that those of you who have children, maybe you get glimpses of what freedom is sometimes when you have a connection between you and your child that is unsullied by anything else except for that one minute connection for that minute. And then you have to become the parents and do this, that, or the other, or whatever you. But there must be moments that you sense that. I don't have children, but I sense that feeling of wholeness and knowing why you're on the earth and why the earth is what it is somehow close to being what freedom really feels like.
That's pretty good.
I think that's good. A wonderful response. We have reached 1 o'clock and we told you we'd finish now. Lemn and Michael, thank you for the generosity of your minds.
Thank you.
Which we've all enjoyed today.